Okay, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
So, a couple of things before we actually begin the services tonight. First of all, the most important thing of all is for all of you who are out here, you know, friends and neighbors or co-workers of Jack, it's important that you know from the very beginning how much the family appreciates you being here. And so do I. Because truly, you make my job so much easier. And I tell you why. Because it's so difficult to say goodbye to the people that you love. And certainly that's true for his children and his grandchildren, you know, nieces, nephews. It's hard to say goodbye. Schedule, in terms of, you know, who's going to be first or second. So anybody who would like to come up, please feel free to do so. But when it's quiet, when no one is coming up, I'm going to come back up and conclude the service. Please feel free.
For those of you that don't know me, my name is Mark Antonio Jr. That's my granduncle Jack right there. His brother is my grandfather. My grandmother is Honorable Brito, his wife. I love you all, just know that. I know that I am a child of God. I am spirit. We are all spirit. And I want to testify right now. I want to tell you a story. I've been living in Washington for the last 4 years. And I was praying one morning, and in my real peaceful place is by the water, really quiet before the world wakes up, the animals are quiet before the sun rises. And I was praying, asking God, what should I do with my life? Where should I go? Who am I to be? What am I? And I got an answer. It told me to go home, that I've been hiding in Washington too long. So I drove here, and the very next day I got here, and my grandfather, 2 days later, took me to my Uncle Jack's house, who I didn't know was sick and on his way out to the next life. And I got to talk to him, and I'm so grateful. I can barely make out about a quarter of what he told me. But what he did tell me, it was such relief. It took so much weight off my chest. Do you want to know what he told me?
Yes.
I'm going to share it with you anyway. He told me, Mijo, you're heaven bound. That's what I did, and he made him laugh. I kissed his feet. My grandfather, my papa, I love him. Hey, hot dog! That's what he's gonna say to my brother Georgia right there. I love that. I be playing with my toys. He come in, and I heard him before I saw him. Hey, hot dog! Oh God, I love him. I can't wait to be with him again. He's here right now watching. That's what I believe. That is my testimony right now. I'm gonna give you all some time to share yours. I hope everyone can look here. Hopefully nobody's long-winded. You all love me. I love you. God bless you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I don't know what I'm going to do without it. his sense of humor was kind of strange at times. And my mom had taken me to this window, and she bought me a small bear. It was the ugliest little thing, but it had a teardrop, and it was sad all the time. And I carried it around like, you know, it was my baby. He calls me Tammy, come here. What, come here, boy, again. Let me see your baby. And I was wondering why he said, let me see your baby. So I gave him my bear. He proceeds to pick it up and he punched it across the So I ran screaming. My mom comes down the hallway, leave her alone. And he just thought it was the funniest thing. And every day that I carried that bear around, he would ask me, let me see your baby. But I loved him more for it every day. I'm going to miss him a lot. Those that don't know me, my name is Irene Brito Guerrero. I was my mom and my uncle Jack Brito's sister. And I have to admit that my uncle Jack was larger than life. We knew when he was there. I remember as a child, he would ring the doorbell and I'd be running because I knew it was Uncle Jack. And what would he say when he reached me? Hey, baby, how are you? He'd come in and Mom, of course, was always happy and she'd sit down and she'd be conversing with him. He says he's hungry. She'd cook eggs, bacon, chorizo, tortillas, biscuits, everything, and Uncle Jack was there as happy as could be. And then they start talking about when they were little and what have you, and all of a sudden the house would start booming because Uncle Jack was talking loud, and then my mom was talking loud, and then everybody was talking loud, and it was hell crazy. It was like Uncle Al was there, and sometimes Uncle Bobby, and Sheila sometimes too, but it was really crazy. But I'll tell you, this man was phenomenal. He did so many things for the family, and not only for the family, but friends and people that he met. He was a pioneer. He helped the Chicano movement. He was, I believe, under Governor Brown, he was state commissioner of highways. I believe that's right. I know that he was an instructor at San Jose University. And I can't say enough about how good he was in helping all. And I want to thank my Aunt Virginia, because without Aunt Virginia, I mean, he was a strong man, but she was always there. She was always a bad guy. My cousin Jack, my cousin Peggy, my cousin Carmen, my cousin Ginger, my cousin Tally, I'm trying to remember everybody, and all the extended family. See, I don't know everybody here. I was able to meet some of them today, which was great. But I just wanted to share just a little something about my Uncle Jack. But I love my Uncle Jack. I thank him for helping everyone, including my family. So that's pretty much what I have to say, and thank you.
I want to thank everyone for coming. This is a glorious day. You know, my dad was our hero. He was. Every time we had a problem, every time we had to go to that person, it was Dad. Whether we were right or we were wrong, and if we were wrong, he told us we were wrong. And if we were right, he told us we were right. There are so many memories that I have of him, but the sweetest one is, while he was sick, in the hospital, I went to him, and I was able to talk with him, and I asked him to receive the Lord, to receive the Lord Jesus. That I wanted him to be saved because I wanted to see him in heaven. And he looked at me and he smiled. And he said, okay, let's do it. And that's the kind of man he was. It was just do it and get through it. And we did. And so we said this in his prayer. And we took communion. And we had a wonderful time. I read him scripture. So I know that he's in heaven. And I'm not grieving. I'm happy and I'm excited because I know where he's gone. And he went and he laid to rest and we were there. Us girls were there and we gave him his wish. He didn't want to be alone. So we were there with him. We washed him, we cleansed him, we washed his hair. And then he said, goodbye. But this man is... sometimes can make me so mad. Sometimes you can just love on him and he would say the sweetest things. You know, and I'm gonna miss when I walk in the house and he'd say, hey, Josh. You know, and I knew he was talking to me. So, you know, I know what love is and I'm okay with that. And I'm honored that I was able to share that with him and get him saved and, you know, read him that scripture that he enjoyed. And I was even able to sing to him. And, you know, he rested. And he would hold my hand, you know, in the hospital. And we talked, we had our moments, and it was beautiful. So those are the things that I'm going to hold on to and that I choose to remember. So thanks again. Thanks for coming.
There's not many things that I can say that, you know, nobody doesn't know about this man. He was a great man, you know. Hope that one day, you know, I can come up to maybe a fraction, a percentage of what he, you know, showed me, what he's done for everybody. You know, he did a lot of things for everybody. You know, touched a lot of lives. So, you know, just like a memory when I was a little one, you know, I remember going up to him and, you know, hey, Grandpa, I went to go kiss him, and he kissed me, and he slapped the shit out of me, you know? You know, not me, he just, but that was a lesson right there. This world throws shit at you. Excuse my language, it's the way I speak. And, you know, you gotta be tough. You know, it's a common thing, like, everybody went to him. I went to him when I was in need of wise words, and he always gave them. You know, I'd call him, hey, Grandpa, how you doing? You know what I mean? Me was like, I'm like, oh man, river, I just keep flowing, you know? So, you know, he's a great man, and, you know, thank you everybody for coming.
Big influence on my life, you know, all my life was a mess when I first met him. About an hour before I had to turn myself into San Quentin, I stopped at his office, gave me some advice, you know, and from that moment on, my life flourished, you know, and I never forgot what he told me, you know. And he just looked at me and he goes, well, Mr. Holmes, Robert Holmes, he folded his arms, he looks at me and goes, comes a time in a man's life when a man's got to make a decision. Robert Holmes got to start doing for Robert Holmes and forget all these other people out there, you know. So I never forgot that, and then I went to jail. And like Joaquin says, and Karma says, and you know, he's done so much for so many people, you know, like, you know, by the things he says what he does for all people, man, and he's helped me out so much, man, that, you know, words can't even express. You know, he's been like a father to me for 30 years. And, you know, thanks.
I came out to take care of him. friends would talk. Me and my aunt would sit there and talk, and he'd be like, hey, how would you guys talk on Sunday? So pretty much he's telling us to shut up. But I want to share something. He's a singer, and at first I thought he was just making up songs and just rambling on. But hopefully you guys can hear. It's only like 30 seconds. But this was like 2 weeks before he passed. I was with him. And he's like, I want to sing you something. And he sang me this whole song. And I like how he comes with it. So let's see.
Like I said, my sisters were able to go along with it because, you know, they didn't get it too bad. Although, you know, he was a yeller. But he loved all of his kids, man. There's no doubt in my mind, you know. And he loved me just as much as he loved the rest. You know, and I'm going to miss him, man, you know. And damn it, man, you know, I wish I had just a little bit, a couple more days, man. Couple more days, you know. When he passed, I got to kiss him when he was still warm. You know, and I'm never going to forget that for the rest of my life. He was a good guy, my dad. And, you know, he was loved by a lot of people. And I just want to tell everybody here that I appreciate you coming out tonight. And thank you very much for my house, which is
know what you're doing right now, but you get down. So I did. I just got out of surgery. I never forget to look at his face when they wheeled me in his room. It looked like he felt more bad for me than I did for him. I got to spend the last couple of months with him. And I walk in one day, and the girls are telling me, he wants to get in the jacuzzi. What are we going to do? Put him in there, I guess. He turned to the guys and said, what's up? He's a big man. So I walk in one day. Daniel, I need a ramp for the jacuzzi. And I looked at him and said, okay. So I built him one. He sat there in his chair and watched me.
A few months he was I just want to let you guys know that this man right here had the most exceeding sharp intelligence that ever came, to California. He was sharp. Y'all know him as sharp. I believe that God gave him that intelligence, and he used his intelligence. God used your intelligence for a reason, and he used it for major breakthrough. He shifted, you know, shift things. If you were in office, he was going to make sure you got out of office so he could put someone in a better, and put them in place to make some better positive difference. He did that. And he made a difference with everybody. I mean, his voice. My gosh, let's talk about his voice. Everybody, you know, I talked about it with some of the ladies a couple days before he had passed. That his voice, oh man, his voice was special. When he spoke to you, like he said, they were speaking in nicknames earlier. Oh my gosh. So he had a nickname for everybody, as far as I knew. And he had a way to speak to you. His voice captivated the room. And with you, he zeroed in on you. And he spoke to you with the term of endearment. And you could feel it. I mean, it touched the depth of your heart and soul. For me, it did. I have a lot of stories. I'll share a few. There's one. So one day, I was about 6 or 7. And this is outside the hot dog, when I tell you the hot dog. I was sitting down playing. So I just want to let you know once again, I'm Robert Brito's grandson, George. And so they were talking. And as you know, if you don't know, my grandfather used to like to tease me with a big smile and pull out his big wad of money. And sometimes he let me touch it, but he took it back down. He last minutes and acting, you know what I mean? So, but they were talking one day, right? And I was playing toys. I was in the front room, grandparents' house. You know, like I said, keep in mind, I was about 6, 7. And they started talking, you know, I don't know if they were bragging, but they were talking about stuff and moves they were going to make. And they were talking about, like, you know, I remember Jack was saying, he was telling my grandpa, he said, these $100 bills, they're like pennies to us. And I don't know what he brought it up again, they were talking about it, and I kept bringing it in my head. And I said, I'm going to articulate a conversation with them about this in a minute. But yeah, $100 bills, like pennies, this and this, you know, buy me this and this and that. And they're talking, and my grandpa was like, yeah, he's agreeing, right? So I decided to go over there. I'm with my toy and I'm dangling it in my hands. And I said, hey, since $100 like pennies to you guys, you know, I just wanted to spend a couple pennies around here. And they started to laugh at me, shit, rub my head, told me, go on, play now. You know what I'm saying? So I did, right? But they, you know, tickled them and stuff in their heart. And I just wanted to share a little bit about that. As far as me being hot dog, I walked in the kitchen one day, I don't know why, but he decided, he said, I said, I don't know why I had a bunch of food popping in my head, all kinds of stuff. Eating pizza, because I do love pizza, let me tell you. So I said, hot dog, right? So hot dog, right? I don't know what it was, but every time he seen it, he called me hot dog, right? So, you know, like I said, his voice was very endearing and touching, so he captivated and grasped me. Every time he looked at me, he loved me. Like people, like, when you guys talk about, you can meet him at the door, you felt his love, powerful presence. You can see him in the kitchen. He captivated you with his endearing nickname with you. And he always, hot dog, right? How you doing, daddy? How you doing, papa? You know, and then, what's going on with you? And he really wanted to know what's going on with you. And he would be able to touch you and to lift you up in spirit. He was a big time encourager. He would encourage you. Anybody been in here, you know, he could encourage you. He had your back. He was a strong man. Like I said, he had the sharpest tongue to come over here in Northern California. And he was no joke. He made shifts and moves like no one ever believed. He's part of the Chicano movement. We stumbled across about, I'm pretty sure, I encourage you guys that he deserves all the YouTube views he can get, because we stumbled across YouTube. You want to hear him? Touch my heart just to hear his voice, just to hear that him sing that song right now. Oh man, I've seen everybody's body language change when I heard his voice right now. That's how he still had that effect. And if you look on YouTube, I mean, he breaks it down from the being commissioner and talking to people and big moves. Once somebody had told me I'd shared something with them, I wasn't too sure if he's that from Jimmy Hop or not, but I shared it with one of my Christian brothers. And he goes, oh, George, did you see it with Jimmy Hop? I said, I don't know, brother, but let me tell you, when he sits with me, he sits with Jesus now. Because the one day I went and prayed with him, I know they had sat with saying the sinner's prayer and everything, but I wasn't aware of that. So So I wanted to confirm that one of the days in April when I sat with him, I said, Uncle, I just wanted you to know I'm not perfect, but I asked God in my life. And he said, Daddy, he said, we all get to stage, we're not perfect. And there was again encouraging me, even in his state on that bed. And you know, just to see that kind of strength that man had, even in that bed, he was going to give you the encouragement he could. And then after I said that to him, he goes, you know, Daddy, I see you. I know you see, you say big, beautiful prayers during Thanksgiving when you had my grandmother and grandparents' house. And so, you know, I just was so touched. And I said, well, you know, can I walk you through a prayer? It's the, you know what I mean? It's the prayer that basically gets you right next to him, you know, walk through the pearly gates. And he said, sure. He allowed me to sit with him there too. And I, God's honest truth, I felt the Holy Spirit hit the room. And it just was 100% confirmation that after we had prayed, I just prayed on him, and I knew the Holy Spirit was there, so I know he sits with Jesus now. So he's in a better place. And he did use intelligence, like I said, that was God-given. There's a lot of things that's given to everybody here. Everybody has their own gift. Y'all here, y'all custom made. That's why you have your fingerprints. And it can be, you can be identified, right? You know what I mean? And so when God made every one of you, he cut the mold. There's only one you, and there was only one him, and he made a major difference. And I know he sits beside Jesus right now. I can confirm that. I felt it in my spirit. I told him, as me and my brother were sitting next to him, at some of the moments. But then I like to command all the, you know, his daughters and everybody, every family member that was there by his bedside that loved him, because, you know, he poured into all of you. And I love the way you guys poured into him back. And I was there with him. I wish I could, like you know, his son said, I've been there another day, another second, another hour, because his presence was so captivating and so touching. He touched my heart, and I will forever miss him. And so, I love Uncle Jack, and I did tell him, please be waiting for me in heaven. And he said, yes, Daddy, I'll be waiting. My arms are open. God bless you. Oh, one more thing, guys. If he's ever touched your life in any positive manner, could we all just give a round of applause for him right now?
She's spoiled, isn't she? Of course, yes, she is. The most spoiled, right? He always called me all together when I was little because my face, he says my face was all scrunched together. And I said, gosh, Grandpa, I'm in the hospital, you know, we're joking around. He's talking to me and my husband, and I go, Grandpa, I just want to know. Please tell me, do you think my face is still all together? And he laughs and he says, yes, me and I will always be all together. I thought it spread out a little bit, but yes. So I just want to say, you know, I thank everyone for being here today. He definitely had a big impact on everyone, and especially me. I love you, Grandma. Thank you.
About 4 years, me and my grandma didn't see
eye to eye. And I remember thinking like, oh my gosh, this old man is so mean. Like, why is he doing this to me? And he would tell me, he goes, you're going to think of me one day. And I would be like, yeah, right. I'm not thinking right now. You know? And he would tell me, you're going to think of me one day for this. You know, it's a tough lesson. And he would thank me. And, you know, it took me a while to realize what it was he was doing. And he would tell me, you know, this is going to make you a better mom, a better person. And it took me a little while. And I was upset with him for a little while. But recently, you know, the last couple of years, I finally realized I went to him one day and I said, Grandpa, thank you. He goes, thank you for what? I said, I realized what you did and I really, really appreciate it. And, you know, and I remember one of the last nights I just got to spend time with him. We stood up watching TV, he was just talking and talking and talking. And then he goes, I just want to let you know that I love you and you're beautiful and, you know, I think you're a great mother. And I actually just started crying. You know, those words to me meant so much. And I'm never going to forget that. And I just want to let you know I love you so much, girl. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Peggy, Jack's oldest daughter. And I was in charge of taking care of him. First part was easy because he wasn't sick. I just fed him and he goofed around and drank beer and watched TV. After he got sick, he came out of the hospital because he had 6 days to live. That was at the end of April. He lasted until October 20th. He enjoyed proving people wrong. From the time he came over from the hospital to the time he passed, he was basically a daddy behaving badly. Anything he wasn't supposed to do, he did. Smoked the pipe, got in the jacuzzi, ate stuff he wasn't supposed to eat. But, you know, I wanted to make sure that he enjoyed every last day that he had. I'm going to miss him every day. And I'm sorry, I'd like to dedicate to him.
Come on. the pickets at San Jose State for us to get in. It wasn't too long ago, Micos and Micas, they would not serve Negros. It was dogs, Negros, and Mexicans. Okay? So I need to get a main amen here that we're here. And si se puede, we're going to stay here.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
And the Lord is going to guide us. But remember that this man is the trunk of your tree, your family tree, your clan. Now it's up to you young ones to go ahead. My mother is in a nursing home. She too is ready to leave. She, I don't believe she's been told. I didn't tell her about Mr. Brito. She had a great affection for him and the family, Bob. And then there was Willie, if I can remember. And she was always feeding them. She used to remember when Bob, Mr. Brito's brother, would sneak in and get some enchiladas. Luckily, I had the foresight to write down her recipes, but it's not the same. And please, now that we're older, talk to us. Ask us. We're not asking you to come and wipe our tails. We're just asking you, pay attention. We've got a lot of things to sell you so you can dodge the bullets we did. Because you know what, honey? Somehow we went backwards. Amen. You know? And the Lord wants warriors right now. And we have to protect ourselves. No matter what color you are or what your thing is, it's just respect. Respect and your own spiritual need on how to reach out and give love. And most importantly, I know that this is a sad thing. My mother and I have not spoken in 3 years. She got angry because she wouldn't go to nursing home, but I couldn't take care of her anymore. When you are a caregiver, no one knows. Que te da una tristeza, you're sad. You want to give them life. You saw this powerful pillar of strength, and they become a little person. You want to help them. They cry because they're in pain. They want to be like they were, but we can't. Mom went blind. She couldn't move. A proud woman. But I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. And because of that, she was hurt. But I've gone. We tried to talk. And if you knew Benny, he said, ya pa que vienes. You know, so I just leave it at that. A lot of her children, she never thought that, but she asked us to put her in the nursing home. So when your older ones are giving caregiving, give a little love to the caregiver come in. Because we feel guilty, we feel alone, you start feeling resentment. Esta no me ayudó, this one's out of his stereo, this one wants his house. And by the way, Mr. Brito helped a lot of people gain homes. The fixer-uppers, you young ones don't know. This man did a lot without boasting. And that's like in the Bible. Don't be like the Pharisees pounding your chest. Do it, just do it in silence.
That's right.
Okay? So continue by honoring him. This is a celebration of his life. This is life. You should have lived his life. First of all,
Jack for
always said that, you know, it's okay for, you know, a grown man to cry, you know. I was 22 and when my dad passed away, and Uncle Jack was there for us. He helped with the us getting a lawyer. And I'll be honest with you, when he suggested this one gentleman be the lawyer, I was like, just not pay. And let me tell you, his name was Mr. Adams. You know, Uncle Jack had faith in him. And, you know, Mr. Adams did his job. So, like I said, he's not blood related in a sense, but I always call him Uncle Jack. And spent a lot of time with him. I used to go to my Aunt Annie's, and I'd drive up and I'd see the Cadillac, and I'm like, well, we're going to get educated today. I did watch some of the YouTube videos the last couple of days and learned a lot about Jack. I did not know where he was born. I tell you what, at his age, he was telling these stories. I have a hard time remembering what I did last month. And this man was, yeah, he still had it up here. I'll tell you the one thing I'll miss, though, is that voice. I did want to wear, I don't even know what it's called, hat that Jack wears. I wanted to wear one of those tonight. But, yeah, so I just, you know, the balance of those are just, you know, we are so grateful for him. And that will be missed.
Hi, my name is Ruth. I was Jack's first wife. And I've had the honor of knowing the family for about 43 years, a long time. And I've got to live with them, mom and dad, and had great conversations with dad. And I called him on the phone, and he was very, very intelligent. I'm going to miss him as he comes. And I love you guys. You're like my family. Love you.
Love you.
I am his ex-wife's adopted son.
Thank you.
20 years old when I met him. I just moved back from New York, and when you want to become political, you want to become involved in your community, you go to those people that are involved. And that was Jack. That was Jack. He's an icon in this community. He's a legacy. I don't have to tell you as a father to you, a grandfather to you, he was an amazing, incredible leader here. He taught us so many things. He taught us that we had to fight for what we believed in. He taught us that we had to stand up for our rights. He told us what was unjust and that we should move to create justice in this country, not only for each other, but for our community. He was the one that was the first Chicano who stood beside Latinas. When we created the Mujeres Aztlan, there were other Chicanos that were like, oh, why do you have to create a separatist thing? It wasn't a separatist thing. It was the thing that we felt that we had to organize ourselves as women. And he was the one Chicano in this community that was there supporting us as Latino women. And he supported our efforts. He supported education. He supported my going to college at the University of Santa Clara and getting my degree. He told me, go for your dreams, Shirley. Don't stop until you reach them. And as grandchildren to him, great-great-grandchildren, that's the same message that you should remember that he gave to us. And so there wouldn't be anything unless I said a Cesar Chavez quote, because he loved Cesar. He loved Cesar Chavez, and he loved the movement, and he loved the Lord's work done. And this is what Cesar Chavez said, and this is what your grandpa stood for. We cannot seek achievement for ourselves and forget about progress and prosperity for our community. Our ambitions must be broad enough to include the aspirations and needs of others for their sake and for our own. That's what Jack was about. He created change for our community. He created change for all of you so that you could one day live in a world that was fair and just. Unfortunately, today it's not fair and just, and we still have to keep the fight. We will, Jack.
Getting in people's faces. What I'm saying to you is that somebody else spoke earlier and said that it's your turn. The young people here, it is your turn. It's come back around, and we have got to stand up to it again. And let me tell you, my parents were frightened because they couldn't afford to send me to school. I worked three jobs. They would crash camps to give me money because that was all they could send me. So that I was walking out after only teaching a year and a half, my parents freaked out, as did my family. But I knew it was the right thing to do, not only because of what I had experienced, but because I had these icons standing next to me that said, look beyond your selfishness. Look beyond your little world and wearing Gucci shoes or buying at the top stores. Look at the poverty, look at the racism, and look at the sexism. And confront it, knowing that there will be consequences. And be ready for that. That's what your father, your grandfather, your brother, your husband, your tío, your primo, that's what he stood for. Please, please, young ones, make his life stand for something that is still gonna incorporate justice for all of us. All of us. God bless you.
Okay, one more. I have to say that was, I'd like to end when it's inspired like that. And leave you with a message. So, Doctor, really, thank you for giving that. One more.
I'm Anthony Brito. My dad was Lalo, Uncle Jack's younger brother. I met Uncle Jack back in the 60s, early 60s, because I remember going to his house, 10 o'clock at night. I was spoiled. I was a baby. My father, Lalo, and so I know the tennis, both of them. So sorry, her brother and sister, they're jealous. They're jealous. The baby, my dad, never hit me. He should have knocked me out before he died. But he died in 74. And I remember in the 60s, Jack and I spent the night in our house. So we'd go over there, pick up Jack, on Jack and Beaver. Caught his chair, sitting down on the paper. And then take up Jack, and take cousin Jack back to the house. He wanted to spend the night. That usually happened a couple of times a year, two, three times a year. I remember going to the movies with my cousin Jack. I was only like 5 years old. I remember Uncle Jack, he was a tough, tough man. He was loud. I remember him having a rally back after my father died in 74. I remember 76 when they killed Trevino, cop shot him. I remember going to the rally downtown. I hear my Uncle Jack yelling at the board of supervisors, the council members, cussing at him, down like it was. He didn't take no hope. But he gave it. He wanted to get physical. But that's the way he was. He was tough. A lot of it was fun. Because he was very good inside. He was very good inside. And like he says, he called everybody his favorite, including me. But I remember back in the
1960s, every year we went just to retreat then. Every year, we used to. My Uncle Bobby, I got two favorite uncles, my Uncle Bobby and my Uncle Jack. And they're both beautiful, very beautiful people. I'm very proud of my Uncle Jack because, for one thing, he didn't help everybody. Not just his family, he helped everybody. He went out of his way to the prison system. Everybody, he helped everybody. He helped me. I needed him alone, he would leave me alone. But by the time I got alone, he was already sharp. He needed something collateral. I remember 10 years down the line, Danny wouldn't spend the night. So we go up 10 to 11 o'clock at night, pick up Danny and my dad. My dad couldn't go nowhere. I was right there. He'd be driving down the street, and I'd pop going around. Uncle Jack's laughing. And Annie's laughing, and Sally's laughing. Everybody's laughing, they don't know why they're laughing. They're gonna finish the job. They're gonna finish the job. They kept the family together. Aunt Sheila, Aunt Sally, Uncle Jack, my dad, Uncle Bobby, they kept the family together. Every year we got together. And this went on for years. It was beautiful. I remember, that was part of my, I used to go to his office, and you go, I'm gonna go to lunch, and I go, oh, okay. And he opened the door for me. I opened the door, and it's the chief of police. I remember working for Stephen Manley, the lawyer, the judge now. Him and Jack were best friends. You know, I used to open the door, the governor prompted me in the car, in the back seat, and get chauffeured, and open the door. Put my Uncle Jack in the car with the governor. He did a lot. He did a lot, and I have a lot of respect for my Uncle Jack because he wasn't selfish. He didn't only love his wife.
So it's awesome. Rarely do I come and hear so many accolades about a person's life. And truly, I think it's wonderful. So what are you going to do now?
Don't let them.
Come November, do something. Keep your rights. Keep Jack's spirit alive. So I'd like to end with this poem. It's entitled The Dash, because I think it fits and is appropriate. I read of a man who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend, and he referred to the dash on his tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came his date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. For that dash represents all that